Hi, my name is Dave Smith, and today we're finishing module 4, talking about keeping grandpa on track. So we already talked about grandpa. He's trying to handle his own meds because grandma is rehabbing at a skilled nursing facility. And right now we want to try and identify ways that you can optimize grandpa's adherence to the medications that you've taken a long time to try and make perfect. So grandpa, we know, we can read this before, he's 82 years old, a lot of diseases, a lot of medications. And we've tried to take out a lot of these medications, optimize them, identify any adverse drug reactions. But the best laid plans are never gonna work. All that is gonna mean nothing unless grandpa actually takes the medications. So you've done your identifying and evaluating and assessing, but now it's time for you to develop a game plan to try and get grandpa to take his medications, remove the barriers for him, and empower him as a patient. So let's get started. The main thing is to keep the patient and the caregiver in the center of all your interventions. And this has to be a multimodal thing. You have to consider med calendars, med education, adherence, functionality. Reminders can be difficult, but we'll touch on it, and same thing with the 40 medications. So probably some of the lower hanging fruit in this scenario, for me, is calendars as an adherence tool. Now, most of the hospitals and places you might rotate could have institution-specific mechanisms for creating a medication calendar, like through your EMR. But it could also be as simple as an Excel spreadsheet. Some online considerations, you can Google it, find tons of them. One that I actually like the best is My Med Schedule. It's relatively straightforward to create a profile. And it's nice because it's clear, it shows pictures of the medications, and it's very simple when they're supposed to be taking them. Now, any calendar can work, but a calendar in a patient's native language is probably going to be the most powerful. At San Francisco General Hospital, we have a lot of non-English speaking patients. In this case, it was a Swahili speaking patient, and we use a program called Medication for a tool for our CHF patients. You can see they also include pictograms, which has actually been shown to increase understanding of how to take a medication, when during the day to actually take medications. Now, med education. This can probably take up an hour and a half, 2 hours all by itself. I'm not going to belabor the idea of the teach-back method, which is something I know you've heard in this point in your education. But one thing to emphasize also is brown bag sessions. So brown bag, it's fairly easy to actually give you a brown bag. Have your patient put all the medications there and bring them back. Now, as a doctor, you probably don't have a whole lot of bandwidth. So consider actually having dedicated sessions just to do this. And it doesn't have to be you. This is where you should start to call upon other healthcare professionals like a pharmacist, a social worker, a nurse, especially when they can go and visit the home, to make these types of interventions. So next we can talk about ways, some adherence tools, and some functional considerations for your geriatric patient, including medi-sets, blister packs, and trying to utilize a single pharmacy to fulfill your patient's medications. So blister packs. These things are essentially pre-packed, usually by retail or outpatient pharmacies, and they're all the medications that a patient may take. Now, you literally will just push the medication through the blister there, take them every single day. Now, they usually give patients 2 to 4 weeks of medications at a time. And when you think about it, only chronic medications should probably be put in here. So medications that are titrated up and down a lot, for instance, warfarin, or as needed medications for pain are not things that should be in blister packs. And while this is a good idea going forward, you should also be cautious if you have a patient who you're making lots of medication changes for, like grandpa. If he has up to 4 weeks of medications in blister packs at his home, you're gonna have to take that into account when you make these changes. And it's something that is very easily overlooked in a difficult transitions of care, say out of a hospital. Now, medi-sets are a little bit different because they're basically rows for every day of the week, and you can put medications in them and you can do them at home. So they don't require pharmacy, which is one of the great things about it. And sometimes they'll have just one square for each day for once daily drugs, or you can have four for a single day. So if you have four times a day drugs. Now, it's wonderful because I think it helps engage the patients in actually understanding when they're taking their medications, recognizing their medications better, but you do have to assess whether grandpa actually has the dexterity to open them, which isn't as easy as it sounds. So this actually could be one thing you can prescribe a medi-set, and it could be billed to your the patient's insurance, which is kind of nice. And also, this whole thing can pop out. And so if grandpa or grandma want to go to the park and they need to take their medications, they could put that in their pocket or in their purse and take it with them. But this is something that you should consider evaluating in, say, a brown bag session to see that they're actually doing this correctly. Next, we're going to talk about reminder assessments. This isn't directly applicable to a lot of the geriatric patients who may not be as tech savvy compared to it, but it may be applicable, say, if grandpa's nephew or his grandson or granddaughter are taking care of him. I'll show you a quick screenshot of my med schedule, which is actually one that I like. It's a very easy online app that can promote reminders and keep an active medication list that the caregivers can take with them to their grandpa or grandmother's doctor's appointments. Lastly, we're going to talk about affording medications. Now, this literally could be about an hour and a half, 2 hour lecture all by itself. The thing I want you to take into account is if you're going to make medication changes, just be aware that trying to prescribe generics and on the patient's formulary is going to be so helpful in making those drugs available to your patients. And that insurance that kind of seems out in the ether, it can't be changed, those actually can be optimized. And here in San Francisco, if it's a San Francisco patient, HICAP is an example of a group that actually can help your patient do that completely independently of your office. So it's something to be aware of. Now, we are all talking about empowering the patient. And if patients are able to go onto websites, here's a list of some common websites that are more patient-focused. And then a couple that, for you as a provider, can also be used to look up drug information. So we've gone through a lot. I'm not going to go through this whole table, but these are two techniques, SAIL and TIDE, that really kind of summarize a lot of the recommendations we've made all the way from module 1, 2, and 3. I'm not going to go through it. It's in your course syllabus, so take a second to look at it. But if you're in the middle of a clinic visit, SAIL and TIDE are the two things that should be running through your head when you're trying to figure out how to optimize grandpa's medications. So these are the points I really want you to take from this module, is that despite your best efforts, if grandpa isn't taking the medications, it's not going to help him. So it's incumbent upon you to really assess your patient's ability to take the medications, to afford the medications, and don't be afraid to call on other providers to help you out in doing this. So this is module 4. It's the very last one. And I just really want to recognize that taking care of geriatric patients and their medications is a difficult tightrope to balance. Now, I mean, you obviously have your own goals and guidelines that you want to adhere to. You have to worry about polypharmacy, geriatric syndromes, but at the same time, you have to think about the patient. What do they want? What are their goals and prognosis, and what is appropriate for them? And this is a tightrope that you're going to start to experience in your clinical education, and it's probably going to continue for your entire clinical career. So be comfortable with being a little off balance all the time with your geriatric patient and try and stay the course. Lastly, I really wanted to say thank you to Dr. Yukawa, Dr. Aronson, and Dr. Lee for all their help in this module. Thank you.